I remember Columbia Records was interested for some reason signing us, and Phil Walden had the rights, so he signed us to Columbia Records.
There was a producer up there that I met, a man by the name of Tom McNamee. He'd been hired straight out of Yale, and they'd hired him as the brainy one to sit there and tune in on music and to produce records.
I happened to be in the studio when one of my colleagues was listening to, I think, the Allman Brothers, actually, at the Atlanta Pop Festival. On the same tape was the Hampton Grease Band. And I heard this music, and I said, I gotta go to Atlanta, get me a ticket. They had a gig at the 12th Gate. And so there was a fantastic sort of harmony between the lunacy on stage and the lunacy in the audience. I mean, they got what was going on stage.
It was totally insular. It was as if everyone in that group were playing to each other and everyone else could just not be there. For me, it was really kind of movingly cool because it was like, wow, they're obviously not doing it for the money. You know, they're not doing it to get laid, because that probably isn't happening either. Even I could tell that.
A lot of the things in contemporary classical music, multiple rhythms in the same piece, you know, overlapping rhythms where one instrument's playing in 6-8 and another one's playing in 5-8 and another one's playing in 3-4, the Hampton Grease Band was doing that. This bending of tonality that they did was also something that I knew from this so-called, you know, the new music from the serious end of things. And of course, the improvisation that they did was like the best jazz.
He was sincere, and he wanted this band, and he wanted to sign them, which he did.
Colonel Bruce's deal was a six-figure deal, which was very, very, very unusual. There were no huge record deals for Southern bands during that time. To give you an example, Leonard Skinner signed for $9,000, you know?
They all kind of looked at me like, you sure you really want to do this? And I said, yeah, we got it. We got to sign this group.
And then, lo and behold, the agency booked Bruce into the Fillmore East. John Lennon came out.
Frank had invited Lennon to come, and he did Chuck Berry tunes, I believe. We had our best gig we ever had. Yeah, it was a magical two nights.
I think we all thought, this is the beginning. You know, I mean, they've had great success as a performing band, but now they've put out their first record. They're leaving their historical mark, and they're going to get out there in front of America and get famous. Crowd at the Fillmore in New York went wild. They were just crazed, screaming on their feet, and the record wasn't in the stores.
I don't think they kept the record on sale for more than 6 weeks, if that.
They didn't give him enough time to find out whether he could develop or whether Grease Band would develop. He wasn't given that opportunity.
I remember playing the song Halifax for Clive Davis in his office, and he just sort of wrinkled his nose as though he'd been smelling something unpleasant.
Clive Davis thought that Bruce and the music was a scourge to be exterminated at the earliest opportunity. It was a band that needed to be suppressed.
Tom, obviously, with the Hampton Grease Band album and so forth, something like that, things aren't working out for you here at Columbia, and we'd like you to have your desk cleared out by noon.
Worst-selling albums in the history of Columbia Records.
I'm not sure it's found its time yet. I think it's a record that exists in its own space. The record completely succeeds on every one of its own terms. As a one-time statement of a group, it's pretty amazing. You know, a two-record set of really uncompromisingly crazy stuff.
He had the good fortune to make that album, which was an enormous flop, and he had to make some life choices, and the choices he made were heroic. And you know, he's gonna keep on doing it until people got hip to it.
Yeah.